now on to the main feature of this part of the afternoon, and it's my privilege to introduce Tim Fort and Melissa Morris. You won't see Tim Fort very much in front of the classroom because he retired a couple of years ago, so he's a professor emerita. He led the Department of Drama before it was the dance school for several years, and his research is a research in practice. So he was a theater administrator for the Weston Playhouse in Vermont. So he did his prof job and also was an administrator. So he's going to inspire you today with some stories about music theater, and he'll be joined by current professor, music theater specialist Melissa Morris. Those of you taking Muth 210 probably will have Melissa, so you would have met her. So I will call them to the stage and you will give them a nice warm welcome.
Hello, everybody. Thank you. just if there's any confusion, I'm Tim Fort, and that's Melissa. Little housekeeping here. I'm driving to New Brunswick immediately after this is over, so I'll try and keep it brief. But I prepared just one page, and I showed this to my wife, and she said, "No kidding. You're never going to get through all that." But I had faith, and I went to my dear friend Melissa, and I said, "Look, Melissa, just one page," and she reassured me with,
"There's no way. It's just too much."
So we'll keep it moving along, but the only way I can think of doing that is maybe an occasional musical reminder. So Melissa has worked up something to tell me if I'm going over on some... Thank you, Melissa. Actually, this is a good lesson right here for those of you who think you might want to become composers. That song, which a lot of you are going, isn't that the final bit of Jeopardy? Was actually composed by somebody named Merv Griffin. He composed it in 1983 for his nephew as a lullaby, and then he took over hosting Jeopardy for a while, and so he moved it in there. And the thing is about composed work on television, film, in the theater, it's subject to royalty. And so there are about 8,000 episodes of Jeopardy that followed. Every time that gets played, Merv Griffin's estate, he's long since died, makes a little money. So that estate has now received somewhere between $80 and $100 million on that little jingle. So if you're thinking of composing, yeah, everybody's jaw drops open. I can do that. Okay, so let me tell you a little bit about what we're going to do today. John Birch, bless his heart, asked me to do this about 3 months ago, and he said, "Can you come and talk a little bit about your inspiration in musical theater?" And I hope there are a few musical theater geeks out there, because we're going to get... Okay, was that Graham Rennick by any chance? Yeah, okay, just as good. And I said, "John, that title isn't going to sell at all. I'll come up with a really clever title." And I came up with "Solving a Problem Like Maria by Being More Chill." And I thought, that'll get them. Well, I don't know. It may still be a little confusing. But one of the things that I felt that was important to do was remind you how personal music and theater and the reasons that maybe you came to dance school are. And I want you to think, and then I'm going to ask Melissa, about your first encounter with musicals or with music or with theater, and maybe the next few, and if that indeed inspired you in some way, if you still carry it with you, because I'm going to talk about how some of my first approaches to musical theater, full disclosure, I was an English major, but somehow I came over to the dark side. Anyway, I'm going to ask Melissa to tell us a little bit about how she first came to musical theater. And I should say that Melissa and I tend to riff a lot because we have taught together for some years now and we're old friends. So I'm going to ask her to riff whenever I lose my concentration. Melissa, tell us about how you got into music theater.
Well, the first musical I saw, thank you, Carrie McKay, She was a school friend of mine, and for her 13th birthday, her parents gave her two tickets to Phantom of the Opera. And instead of taking her loser older brother, she took me, and there I was in Toronto watching this show, and hugely emotionally affected. Never, my family wasn't interested in theater at all. So it was the first time I actually saw theater on stage, and I just remember I don't know when in Act Two, just weeping. And then the curtain call happened, and I'm just crying, and I'm wearing this nice dress, and I'm like wiping my tears. I'm walking into the street crying, and I just realized something profound had happened to me that day. And I don't know, I was hooked, I was bitten.
And that's why you sometimes wear that mask when you're okay, makes sense. So I should say, again, if you think about music and music theater, I can never really fully explain why I've been addicted to it for more than 50 years, but I think it has something to do with all the connections you can make, all the people that I have gotten to know this way, family, friends, and how that, to use John's word, inspired me. I would say people like Melissa, who turns out now to be not only my colleague, my friend, my former student, and somebody who can do stuff that I can't do. Yes, that's Melissa. What is that? Harlequin, your audition? Never mind. So we're going to go back to my strange roots in being interested in music theater and see if any of this reverberates with you as we go through. But we're also going to talk a little bit about how music theater has progressed over the years and see if any of that reverberates as well. So we'll start with that first part. Let's go back to the title here. Solving a problem like Maria. I hope that reverberates with a few of you. Melissa, maybe you could give us a hint about what that means from a little musical written in 1959. I'll give you a hint. There's a nun over there. I hope most of you could sing along with that. But in 1959, when my mother started taking me to musicals on Broadway, I actually lived about 25 miles outside of New York. The first show she took me to was something called Sound of Music. So how many of you are familiar with The Sound of Music? I'm hoping most of you hang around the TV around Christmas time. Good, okay. So the people who gave us Sound of Music were these two guys. Anyone know who they are? Want to shout that out? Thank you, Rodgers and Hammerstein. They actually wrote just the music and lyrics to Sound of Music. It was the last show they wrote because Hammerstein died soon after, sadly. But they had created what we're going to talk to about a little bit about the golden age of the musical theater with other shows that you may have heard of, like Oklahoma, which came in the early 1940s, Carousel, The King and I, and a show called South Pacific, all of which are kind of book musicals that had many famous tunes in them. Let me first of all deal with the how do you solve a problem like Maria issue. The first problem that you might have had if you happened to be like I was, taken as a young boy to see Sound of Music, was the original cast. There was an actress, very famous, very fun-loving actress named Mary Martin, who had had many successes on Broadway, but she was playing Maria. So I'm just gonna show you this is a picture from the original production. So one of the problems you might have to solve is, for those of you who know the movie, is that Maria is a young novitiate, a nun, before she comes to work for the captain. Mary Martin was 45. So that would have been a problem. except I was sitting in the balcony and didn't know any better. But also, in that era, and just try to imagine, I am even Mike today talking to you, but imagine an era before anyone was mic'd in a big Broadway stage. So you needed people who could fill the house, that is, vocally. And Mary Martin was one of those people. Plus, she could fill the house because she had already been an important and much beloved actress on Broadway for the past 20 years. So that's our problem, like Maria. Now, I'm going to jump ahead to the second part of that title, solving a problem like Maria by being more chill. And who could possibly, what could that mean? Does anyone have a sense of what I mean by be more chill? Anyone want to yell up any hints to me? Ever heard of it?
Keeping Tom.
Pardon me?
Like Peeping Tom?
Like Peeping Tom, well that's...
Keeping calm.
She said keeping calm.
Oh, keeping calm, yes, thank you. Thank you, now I will. And I don't keep calm by being a peeping Tom. I should say that right off. So no one has, it's a, yeah.
Locking yourself in the bathroom or party.
Okay, good reference there, and we'll pick up on that. Yes, be more chill for those of you who are musical theater geeks. Oh, sorry, you know what? I'll leave that for a moment because I want to finish talking about solving a problem like Maria. So this is, anyone know what that is?
A record player.
Yes, good. It's a 78 RPM record player. So I don't imagine many of you, perhaps except for Greg Wanless, listened to his first records on a 78 RPM record player. Because that's how you got an original cast album in those days. Here's one, there's Mary Martin. And here's the original cast album for South Pacific, which my parents gave me. Now, an original cast album, most of you don't listen to albums even anymore, but in those days, with 78s, you could only fit one song on the side. So you needed a record player like that, and the original cast album for South Pacific had six albums in it, and that was what, when my parents moved to the next level, gave me to sit in my room at age 9, listening to the original cast album of South Pacific. That explains a lot about how I grew up kind of warped, because among the songs, Melissa will sing you a song that I used to sing to myself over and over, but they gave me one other album, I should say. My parents were not completely cruel. This is the other album they gave me. So between the two, Melissa, play me what I listen, what this, you can imagine me singing this, just close your eyes.
I'm gonna wash that man right out of my hair. I'm gonna wash that man right out of my hair. I'm gonna wash that man right out of my hair and send him on his way.
And in case you don't get the message, we repeat it.
I'm gonna wave that man right out of my arms. I'm gonna wave.
By about
that
now,
man
you could probably sing along, right? Never heard
I'm
the song before.
Wave that man right out of my arms and send him on his way.
Okay, thank you, thank you. That probably will do it. Now, you're saying no wonder his head looks like that. About 20 years later, when I was in Toronto, I met the first famous person that I got to meet in the theater. And this is somebody, you see his name is underlined there, is Josh Logan. And he was the original director of South Pacific, and he also was one of the few people who got part credit for writing the Rodgers and Hammerstein things. And I got to be an assistant director, and Josh was a wonderful man, great director, but a lovely storyteller. And he, it's 30 years after I've been washing that man right out of my hair, and he told me the story about, that's Mary Martin. Now, Mary Martin at 35 was actually age appropriate for the part that she was playing in South Pacific. And she did a song, that song, Wash That Man Right Out of My Hair, but Josh was confused. She never got applause on it. And he ultimately realized that at the end of the song, she came out of the shower scene with all these suds on her head, and the audience was worried about her. So he added a dance break that she could rinse, and she got the applause. Okay, anyway, now getting back to Be More Chill. Some of you clearly weren't aware that that was a Broadway show. It didn't have a really long run, but it had a recent run. And I want to talk to you about how it got onto Broadway while I have you think back about how I got onto listening to Broadway show music on 78 RPMs on those discs in my room when I was 8 years old. Because, here are the people who wrote and created Be More Chill. That's Joe Iconis in the middle. He is the composer, lyricist, and these are all people that in my other life as a theater director in Vermont, I had them in a production called Pump Boys to the Dinettes. It was a glorified review, which they all worked at a country diner. Joe wrote the show. Jason Sweet Tooth Williams was in the show. Molly Hager was right next door at Waitress. She was there for the entire run of that musical. And Grace McLean was in the Great Comet of 1812. None of them were doing that when they were doing this show in 2015. It was just before a lot of things broke. So a little bit later in that year, Joe's show called Be More Chill opened way off Broadway in New Jersey. And here's the payoff for your comment. This, one song that was a very odd hit from that show is called Michael in the Bathroom. This is George Salazar doing it first off Broadway, then off Broadway, and finally on Broadway. But one of the things that Joe did with the help of Ghostlike Records was release an original sound recording, an original cast recording of this 2015 off-Broadway production. That's unusual. It's unusual to record it, and even more unusual to let it out there digitally. So somehow, it got onto Spotify. I'm just reminding you what I was listening to at the time. Okay, so here's Spotify. So by the time it got to be 2017, that show had been long gone. Spotify recorded 1 million hits for the numbers from Be More Chill and rising. So the people who had originally produced it and some other people said, hey, maybe we have a market for this based on people that we don't even know are enjoying this music. In fact, this happened to me. I was teaching a music theater class, and I was asking for essays on various musicals, and somebody said to me, can I do it on Be More Chill? And I said, how in the world did you even know about that? And he said, Spotify. So they put it up, and by the time Be More Chill got put up off-Broadway, it had 150 million hits on Spotify. And by now, there's somewhere around it, of course, it had a short off-Broadway run, went to Broadway, played for about a half a year, and now there's somewhere near 350 million hits of the music for Be More Chill. So if you haven't heard it yet, you know where to go. But the important thing is that's a long way from listening to shows on 78 RPMs, needing all the gear and so forth. So the economics and the manner of getting shows out and getting us to know and listen to shows have changed incredibly. That's lesson one about, you know, come up with a title and then you learn stuff. I came up with a title about solving a problem like Maria by being more chill, not realizing in any way that it was connected, but that's how my life goes. Okay, we're going to do a Joe Iconis song from an earlier show that he wrote called Black Suits. And one of the other things I'd like to explore here is how the voice has changed over the years from Mary Martin singing Gonna Wash That Man Right Out of My Hair, and the lyrics change to express women or anybody's feeling about their hair. And Joe Iconis wrote a song for this show called Black Suits. You can see there Krista Rodriguez doing it in a workshop. There's Ben Platt who did another earlier version of this show, which has still not made it to Broadway, but both of those people have. So, Melissa, a song from the Black Suits by Joe Iconis, please.
Sure.
I'm bored, I'm awesome, it's almost one. The internet's down and my homework's done. I'm sick of brown, it looks like fun. So I'm gonna dye my hair blue. I'm independent, I'm totally rad. Gonna dye my hair, gonna make Chris mad. And he'll make a snotty face. And I'll say you're not my dad. No, oh, I'm gonna do what I want to. I wanna dye my hair blue. And it's gonna look like wonderful, super fantastic coolness, remarkable. Wonderful, super fantastic coolness, remarkable. Wonderful, super fantastic coolness, remarkable and blue.
Thank you, Melissa. Anybody who has ever been taught by me or knows me, this was the wall of my old office. So there may be a hint here that someone was a Stephen Sondheim fan. And so I thought I would try to focus my ramble a little bit around two thoughts that Stephen Sondheim has given me. One starts with a musical. My first Sondheim musical was one that I saw in 1971. It's there on the wall. It's called Company. And it was about a 33-year-old white male named Bobby, B-O-B-B-Y, who could not launch. He had good married friends. He had a number of female friends who tried to get him to, you know, make something of his life. Couldn't quite do it. And so it sounded different from any other musicals I'd seen at the time, and I'd seen, you know, Sound of Music and that sort of music, golden age music stories. It sounded like some of the opening numbers sounded like it was written to the tune of an answering machine, which comes into play, actually, in that opening number. Anyway, there's a lyric that's sung by the married friends of Bobby to him, explaining to him what they think marriage is. And I think it's pertinent way beyond, as most Sondheim lyrics are, way beyond just understanding about marriage. It goes, everything's different, nothing's changed, only maybe slightly rearranged. And the idea here is that, 50 years later, I would see Company again, just last year in 2021. And it happened to be on the eve of Sondheim's death. So it was a really cathartic moment for me. But this is the Company that I saw. Bobby, B-O-B-B-Y, had changed to B-O-B-B-I-E. And the good married friends were not all hetero anymore. There was at least one same-sex couple. You can see this diversity in the couples. So everything's different, but really nothing's changed. The core of the show, if the show was gonna work, had to stay the same. And that's what, when you see a show that gets revived, you hope that whatever it said about society at the time can be changed or updated enough to look like society, the society that you now recognize. And it is that same hope and era that allows us now to, what used to be called non-traditional casting can now allow us to see a show like Hamilton, where the founding fathers of the U.S. are all people of color, without even blinking about it. So I hope that everything's different but nothing's changed means that we can now see shows that are even classics that still tell us something about our society today. There's another show that's a favorite of mine by Sondheim. In fact, they're all favorites. What am I kidding myself? I want to show you a production that was done by Queens Musical Theater in 1997. I want to show you some of people who were in your program, this program, then, and tell you a little bit about where they went and how they are connected. And one of the great songs from Into the Woods, a show that many of you probably know, is No One Is Alone. And I think Sondheim basically likes to help us know about connectivity.
Mother cannot guide you.
So I'm going to tell you a little bit about who was here in 1997. Suresh Jahn, shortly after his time at Queens, wound up on Broadway in a very bad show called Bombay Dreams, but he's still very much in the business. Shane Carty is currently on the stages at Shaw Festival. He's in Damn Yankees, but he's been at Stratford and Shaw many times. I don't know what happened to him. Every once in a while. And Dylan Trowbridge also has a great film career and acting career. Now, the director, Daryl Cloran, and the producer, Claire Sakaki, have done all right, too. And I'm going to link them with one other person and just tell you that the three of them run all the major theaters now in Western Canada. Daryl at the Citadel, Ashley Corcoran, also a graduate of this program just a few years later, the Arts Club, and Claire, Bard on the Beach. And it's their friendship and connectivity that I think also tells me that we're going to have a really healthy world out west.
Just remember, someone is on your side. Someone else is not. While we're seeing our side, maybe we forgot they are not alone.
Thank you, Melissa. So I'm going to try to quickly, no Jeopardy theme, please, trace the idea that everything's different, but nothing's changed, and also that no one is alone. I want to look at some of the connectivity between artists, friends, composers. We're going to look at, we've already looked at a bunch of composers, and we're going to look at four or five more. I think probably the first connectivity worth mentioning is that Sondheim, who wrote that beautiful song, was mentored by Oscar Hammerstein, who wrote the lyrics for Sound of Music and all those others. So there's a huge connectivity there. Both of them really were the pillars of the 20th century musical theater. But we're also going to look at how the theater tried to find new voices, starting with an early piece. And I promise I'm going to try and end early enough so that I can tell you the story of how the person who wrote the longest and most produced, not the longest in terms of length, but the longest running, and most produced show of the 20th century and invented the concept album helped me connect after 50 years with my first girlfriend. And this will be very touching. It's not as sordid as it seems, but we'll get back to them in a minute. But let's start with these guys. Anyone recognize them? Oh, wait. Yes, that of course is Gilbert and Sullivan. And I have often said, for those of you who don't know Gilbert and Sullivan yet, you're gonna know them soon through a major production here, but that for me, William S. Gilbert, the first person, the first playwright to be knighted, 25 years after Sullivan, who was the composer, got knighted, invented what we think of now as musical theater. And that's because They thought they were writing a light opera or operetta or something like that. But basically, one thing they did different from virtually every opera, if you think of just a few famous opera composers, Verdi, Puccini, Mozart, whatever, I dare say, unless some of you are very research intensive, nobody can name the librettist. Nobody can name who wrote the words. What Gilbert did was put the words first. He wrote the story first and gave them to Sullivan, who wrote the music. So when the words and the story lead, you have music theater. This is not to say that opera is not theatrical or musical or anything else. It's just that it's that conjunction, that connection between words and music, storytelling, that really started what I think is the modern era, really the 20th century was the modern era for music theater. Now, they wrote a little bit earlier, and they wrote their second show just for us to do here at Queens. It was called Pirates of Penzance, but you know, for some reason, Graham Rennick keeps turning up. I don't know how that happened. And there's Shane Carty again. This is a production of Pirates at the Weston Playhouse, which is where I worked for 40-some years. Some other people of interest here, Tyler Murray, still from Queens, the program, still very much in the professional world, doing a lot of different kinds of things. Christopher Bond, with somebody sitting next to me at the piano, wrote Evil Dead the Musical. And that, of course, had a nice off-Broadway run, is produced quite often. Usually, if any of you have gone to it, you know you get a poncho if you sit in the front because of the splatter zone and the blood. And then Clark Gessner, this is a mystery. He's going to keep reappearing, so I guess we'll have to get back to him. All right, anyway, so Gilbert and Sullivan, having great success with HMS Pinafore, wrote partly the title of Pirates of Penzance, partly because Pinafore had been pirated in the U.S. by, there were no rights protections in those days. So on a boat sailing to the U.S., they wrote Pirates of Penzance so that the first production could be in the U.S. where it could be protected for copyright. Didn't really work out, but anyway, that was the idea. So one of the things about the invention of musical theater is they couldn't quite leave all of opera behind. So we're going to just do a little bit of one number from the character Mabel. I would say that William S. Gilbert loved to write comic works, and he loved to parody styles. And you'll see that in all his work, including when you see Pirates of Penzance, you'll see his parody of the Deus Ex Machina ending, or you know, turning everything out all right in about 10 seconds. But this is much earlier, when the character Mabel meets the character Frederick, who is a pirate, but not by his own volition. And he's asking all the daughters, for some reason the modern major general has like 20 daughters, all the same age. He's asking one of the daughters if they would be in some way affectionate towards him. This is Frederick. And none of them, for some reason, want to deal with a pirate except for Mabel, who sings a little bit of this.
Poor wandering one, though thou hast surely strayed, take heart of grace, thy steps retrace.
Heart but ours.
Take heart, fair days will shine. Take any heart, take mine heart.
Thank you, Melissa. We'll let you know. That's her self-tape for auditioning for the part. I should mention that Greg tells me there may be one or two parts still to be cast.
Oh.
The auditions are there. Melissa, what was that thing that you were just
doing? The wee little cadenza at the end? Yeah, it's just in operetta and opera, of course, you have little passages and moments for showing off.
Yeah. And you do it well. And Melissa, by the way, teaches music theory, so she'll tell you all about that, maybe demonstrate some of this from time to time. I am about to demonstrate, all right, let's see here. you see me in a lot of slides of record players, but sometime between my encounter with South Pacific and my encounter with My Fair Lady, which was in the early 60s, the record players changed, and instead of just one song at a time, they were 33 and a third albums. So my parents got a new record player, and they also took me to see My Fair Lady, which was playing not very far from us on its first national tour in the early 60s. So this is, you may recognize, though you sound of music fans, this was Julie Andrews' actual first show on Broadway, 1956. And a few years later, of course, she got the part of, in Sound of Music. Ironically, did not get the part when it was a film was made of My Fair Lady. That went to Audrey Hepburn. So we're talking about voices and vocal changes to how musical theater evolved. And one of the things that happened by the 60s is that you could have, so that was Rex Harrison playing Higgins. Now, Henry Higgins is a professor of phonetics, and he meets a young woman called Eliza Doolittle. This is based on a Shaw play, in front of Covent Garden, and she is speaking Cockney, and she distresses him a lot. He's also meets up with Colonel Pickering, who is another phonetics fanatic. And Eliza ultimately follows him home and says, can you teach me to talk better so I can get a better job? Basically, Shaw is looking at how language helps define class and many other things in England at the time. And so Rex Harrison was not a singer, but playing Higgins, he needed to have some musical interludes. So what Alan J. Lerner, who was the lyricist, book writer, and Friedrich Lowe did was write some songs that allowed non-singers to put their point across. What would that be called, Melissa, if a non-singer, it's German, I think.
Sprechte Stimme.
Yeah, I pronounce it Sprechte Timmy. Right.
Sprechte Timme. Yeah.
Okay, so I'm going to demonstrate what happened to me at 12 years old when I saw My Fair Lady. I was determined to play Higgins because I thought, you know, a cranky old phoneticist would be perfect for me. Now, I have been trying for maybe 50 years or more to play Higgins, and nobody will cast me. I decided for today I would do a little Sprechte to Timmy. So I'm going to demonstrate how important an opening number is. Let's go to Covent Garden and get him off the screen. Imagine Higgins outside Covent Garden listening to accents and really delivering the thesis of the show, but not really singing it. Look at her, a prisoner of the gutters, defined by every syllable she utters. By rights, she should be taken out and hung for the cold-blooded murder of the English tongue.
Ow!
Heavens, what a noise. This is what the British population calls an elementary education.
Come, sir, I think you picked a poor example.
Did I? hear them down in Soho Square, dropping H's everywhere, speaking English any way they like. You, miss, did you go to school?
What do you take me for, a fool?
No one taught her take instead of tyke. Hear a Yorkshireman, or worse, hear a Cornishman converse. I'd rather hear a choir singing flat. Chickens cackling in a barn, just like this one.
Gan!
Gan. I ask you, so what kind of word is that? It's ow and gone that keep her in her place. Not her wretched clothes and dirty face. Why can't the English teach their children how to speak? This verbal class distinction by now should be antique. If you spoke as she does, sir, instead of the way you do, why, you might be out selling flowers, too. An Englishman's way of speaking absolutely catastrophizes him. The moment he speaks, another Englishman will despise him. But use proper English, and I'm afraid we'll never get it. Oh, why can't the English learn to set a good example for people whose English is painful to the ear? The Scotch and the Irish leave you close to tears. There even are places that English completely disappears. In America, they haven't used it for years. Why can't the English teach their children how to speak? Norwegians learn Norwegian. The Greeks are taught their Greek. In France, every Frenchman knows his language from A to Z. The French don't care what they do, actually, as long as they pronounce it properly. Arabians learn Arabian with the speed of summer lightning. And Hebrews learn it backwards, which is absolutely frightening. But use proper English, you're regarded as a freak. Oh, why can't the English? Why can't the English learn to speak? Thank you. Okay. I'm accepting offers for the new version of that show. Let's move on to some Canadian content. So that is Galt McDermott, who grew up in Montreal, but he went to New York to try and get some musical theater work, and he wound up working with the two guys who wrote Hair, who are not lyricists in any way at all. But I want to have Melissa do at least a bit of a song for you. So this is 1968, the year for me that shows like My Fair Lady and Oklahoma and South Pacific, which were golden age, kind of moved to somewhere else. And Hair, of course, was a rock musical, so it was orchestrated differently. But Galt McDermott, who's a brilliant composer, had the difficulty of having to take this lyric, which is a stream of consciousness, and turn it into a musical number, which he did very well indeed. And this is, by the way, the third song with Hair somewhere related, so that's good, right? Here we go.
I met a boy called Frank Mills on September 12th, right here in front of the Waverly, but unfortunately, his address. He was last seen with his band, a drummer. He resembles George Harrison of the Beatles, but he wears his hair tied in a small bow at the back. I love him, but it embarrasses me to walk down the street with him. Brooklyn somewhere and wears this white crash helmet. He has gold chains on his leather jacket, and on the back are written the names Mary and Mom and Hell's Angels.
That's That's good. Well, you get the idea. If you read that lyric, you're going, where can I go? How can I make sense of this? But that's what a good composer does. And also, we now hear a new voice in musical theater. I mean, this somebody who speaks like that, sounds like that, brings us more into the contemporary, which was very late 60s, feeling of how musicals can reflect life. And in fact, in Hair, it was the first time that in this tribal rock musical that black people and white people could be on stage together in equal parts. So that tells you a lot about society and what it was doing at that particular time. I'm going to move on to this picture. This is from my theater in Vermont. In 1990, I directed a production of Sherlock Holmes. And what's interesting about this to me, that's Christopher Lloyd, just coming off Back to the Future. And that's his nephew, Sam Lloyd Jr., who was just about to go into Scrubs, and his aunt. And then there's Clark Gessner. He keeps turning up. But we'll get to him in a minute. But also in this particular company was a very young man, just 20 years old, his first professional job. And this is like a Where's Waldo picture in front of the theater. I can tell you where Waldo is. His name is Jason Robert Brown, and he's in front of a pillar. And he's looking very 20-year-old. So if you haven't spotted him yet, he's going on within the next 6 to 8 years to write a Tony Award-winning musical called Parade. But in the meantime, he was the assistant cabaret director, and I ran a cabaret music director. I ran, among other things, a musical cabaret in the basement of the Playhouse here. And Jason wanted to write songs. He was really eager to write songs. And so we did a lot of commentary. Here's, speaking of connecting, here's Chris Lloyd trying to sing Climb Every Mountain, and I'm showing him where the lyrics are on the map. That's Clark Gessner. What? Clark? Anyway, he's singing. He writes a lot of review numbers. And I think this is a number called The Jello Was Always Red that he sang. But more importantly, Jason wanted to write numbers for what we were putting out there. So I said, sure, Jason, you can write the theme music to Ben and Jerry's Star Search. And that was the kind of subtle material we were doing. Or maybe We've Got No Opening Number. And Jason basically said, okay, but I have a number that I'd like you to hear that I wrote, and it goes like this. And basically, we're going to listen to the first song he wrote for a review called Songs for a New World, which I was lucky enough to direct in Toronto, the first Canadian production. And you'll see, once again, more Queens grads. That's Tracy Michaelides, and that's Jason Knight, and not pictured here, Claire Sakaki, who's the producer. So another way to have women talk about their lives in Jason's voice. And by the way, I corrected his grammar when he gave me the song, but he wasn't too mad at me. Anyway, here we go.
Jenny's afraid of water. I mean, she swims so well, but still, she's afraid of water, so she won't go near the sea. Not me. Katie's afraid of darkness. I mean, she sleeps and all, but still, she's afraid of darkness. So when the lights are out, she has to hold my hand. I don't understand. Water, dragons, dark or sky. I'm not afraid of anything. Tell me, where's the challenge if you never try? So watch me fly. I'm not afraid.
Thank you, Melissa. Just two more numbers we're going to, but I think they're important ones. First of all, we're going to go back to Canadian content. You may recognize some faces in this show. This is a rehearsal. But in the middle there is Leslie Arden, more Canadian content, the great Canadian composer, who is currently working on a show with many of us called Lancashire Lass. Some of these other folks, I'm trying to figure out how they got there. Anyway, we have been working on that show for a couple years. Before then, Leslie, who I've known for about 25 years, allowed me to direct the House of Martin Guerre in the Rotunda Theater, which is another epic musical. But the show we're working on is called The Lancashire Lass, and some of you may not have heard of this, but there was this pandemic that went on a couple years ago, which made doing large choral musicals very hard. What I wanted to, so we're still working on it, but in May of this year, finally, the major production. But what I'd like Melissa to do, that's Melissa, in case you can't tell her with the mask. What I'd like Melissa to do is sing what many great composers have. By the way, I always forget to mention this in terms of connections. Leslie studied with Sondheim before she came back to Canada. She studied at Oxford with him. So this is what's known as an I Want song. Usually you have one early in a show. And Melissa actually sings it in the show, and it's this young woman who's working in a factory and wants more.
I don't know what I want, but I don't want this. Slaving away all day in a cotton mill, though you flaunt your marital bliss. I'm well aware it's a marital bore. I don't know what I want, but I know I want more. Mum spent a lifetime at the bobbin. One more wife down the devil's all. It would bleak for 6 days a week with just one day left to save a soul. Oh, meringuing the bleeding laundry, frying bangers and scrubbing floors. That's a mother's unjust desserts. Scrubbing floorboards until it hurts. Jiggling, jingling onto her skirts, all scriking about the endless chores. Is that my life ahead, my life in yours? There's a world out there, Alice, it's true. Pictures full of the novel, the new, and things to do and places that I long to see. There's a purpose out there for me. Yes, somewhere, Alice, beyond these walls, adventure calls.
Some extraordinary performances, Melissa. Prime among them. I have to point out, there he is again. Yeah, that's Graham Rennick. He photobombs everything I do. With some luck, we'll convince him to continue. All right, I know you've all been waiting for the exciting conclusion here of, okay, how the writer of the most produced musical in the 20th century and the inventor of the concept album brought me together with my first girlfriend. And I should add, well, let's look first at, this is the first concert. You're always thinking, oh, you're gonna show The Who's Tommy or Jesus Christ Superstar or something like that. Well before that, Gessner wrote a concept album called You're a Good Man, Charlie Brown, with songs that eventually became part of the show that he wrote. There's Clark right there. He did it kind of on spec because he wasn't sure that Charles Schulz, who wrote the Peanuts comics, would even allow him to do it. But he liked it, they did this, and this is what led to the show You're a Good Man, Charlie Brown. Also led me, a lifelong friend with Clark, who has sadly passed away about a decade ago, but it allowed me to direct him as Snoopy in the 25th anniversary production of You're a Good Man, Charlie Brown. A show that, as I have hinted at, was the most produced show in the 20th century, not always legally, in fact, but because it was producible anywhere by almost anyone, schools did it, everyone did it. Clark, a lovely, lovely person, actually came from, it was born in my hometown, Plainfield, New Jersey, and although he didn't bring us together in a way he did, so we're going to have the exciting resolution to how these two reconnected. I was doing one of these riffs with Melissa, and I brought her a book, Peanuts book, and she looked at it like that, and she gave me the eye like that, and said, I said, you know, I used to read those when I was a kid with Barbie Fisher, who I guess I should figure out what happened to her. We used to read them, and she wouldn't go to school without me. She, you know, I had to walk her to school. And so Melissa, being the little matchmaker that she is, said, well, are there no, you know, Facebooks? Are there no... anyway, so I looked up, I saw that there was a Barbie Fisher from Plainfield, New Jersey, on the internet somewhere. So I did this thing where I wrote an email expecting a cease and desist order. I mean, I wrote a, you know, and it was me in blue. And I'm happy to say that in about 2 weeks, she and I are going to meet in her art studio. She's a painter. Thank you, Clark, for bringing us together. I should say also that nobody calls me Timmy except for one other person. So we are going to finish off today with, if Clark had been able to write No One Is Alone, I think, or if he knew about No One Is Alone, I think he would have known about it. He would have written this song, which for me is the final song of the golden age and moves us into the same year as Hair. Oh, I'm so happy. Look, the little redheaded girl dropped her pencil. It's got teeth marks all over it. She nibbles her pencil. She's human. Gosh. This hasn't been such a bad day after all. Happiness is finding a pencil.
Pizza with sausage.
Telling the time.
Happiness is learning to whistle.
Tying your shoe for the very first time.
Happiness is playing the drum in your own school band. And happiness is walking hand in hand.
Happiness is two kinds of ice cream.
Knowing a secret.
Climbing a tree. Catching a firefly.
Setting him free.
Happiness is being alone every now and then.
And happiness is coming home again.
Happiness is
morning. Daytime and nighttime too. For happiness is anyone and anything at all that's loved by you.
Thank you, Clark. Thank you, Melissa. And thank you all.
thank you very much, Tim and Melissa. Very inspiring afternoon. Thank you, everyone, for spending part of your Friday with us. I hope you are inspired and well-fed. Enjoy the afternoon. Thank you to our tech at the Isabel. And that's the end of our show. So thanks for coming.